So I looked at our blog a couple of months ago, and I realized that I hated it. The writing was decent, but I wouldn't share those articles with the public because the images sucked. The images were from Shutterstock and Getty Images. We're paying thousands of dollars to these companies, but the images were never good. And then I realized that, why are we bothering with this? We could basically create images that are original on our own using AI. So this is what happened. Now, this is using Midjourney. This was the original blog post. How to tell someone if someone likes you. 30 tips from a dating expert. Now look at that image. Super cheesy couple dancing with the sun set behind them from Shutterstock. This is the new image created by AI. It took 3 minutes. Basically, what this means is that if you're not using AI, you are going to be replaced by someone who's using AI. How many of you guys are ready to learn how to use AI to dominate your business and your life? Okay, so first, who here has started dabbling with ChatGPT or Midjourney? Quite a number of you guys. How many of you here use it for about 50% of the work that you do? Fewer hands. But I'm impressed that there are people here who use it for 50% or more of the work you do. I've gotten to this stage. More than 50 work I do today, I use AI to accelerate it. And it's been wondrous, really. It's helped me free up almost immediately. Within 2 weeks of getting into it, it freed up an hour a day for me. But I want to give you an idea of what I'm using it for. We're going to show you prompts that you can replicate and use to train Midjourney, which is an art creation system, or ChatGPT, for your work or business. So before I bring in our first AI expert, which is actually DJ Sammy, I want to share with you just a couple of quick ways I've been using AI. Number one, I use AI to create beautiful imagery for slides. Number two, I use AI for script. When I do a podcast interview, I take the podcast, I feed it into AI, and then the AI tells me the key ideas from the podcast that it predicts can go viral. Then I ask it to write a script. I use AI for creating beautiful conversations. I got an idea from Eric Edmeads yesterday to create a person on AI called Adam, who's 100,000 years old. And just for fun, I talked to Adam and I asked it, Adam, did you ever witness the fall of Baghdad? What was that like? Adam, how did you feel when you first got your hands on a gun? And this character created by AI that's called Adam takes me on a journey of 100,000 years across human history, because I'm a history buff. So I've created an AI that actually communicates with me and helps me understand human history. I've also used AI to write poems for my daughter. And then she thinks her dad is like so amazing and spent hours writing her a poem. But now she knows that I basically just used AI and she's in on the joke. So there are many incredible ways you can use AI. Now, my background is electrical engineering and computer science. So I don't want you to think that I have a special advantage because of my degree. And so I want to invite an artist, Sammy, to come up and share how he is using AI as an artist, as a musician, as a DJ, so that you can see how this is really something that is across the board. Sammy?
Thank you, Vision. Hey, guys. Woo! Okay. I am going to preframe this just a little bit because I'm using this as an artist and as a musician, but I'm actually using it outside of my field because a lot of you guys see me as a DJ and a performer, but I got to be honest with you, I started before I was a DJ. And how many are first-time A-Festers here? There's so many of you. I just want to share a really quick story. The very first time I went to A-Fest, my mind was blown. So many of these speakers are up there, and I was like, I want to be on that stage one day. I can be on that stage one day. I have no idea how that could happen. That was 10 years ago, and now you guys are helping me relive this dream, so thank you guys so much. And the reason I tell you that is because now, more than ever, it does not need to take 10 years. You can do this instantaneously. So ChatGPT, this came along at one of the most incredible times for me, and I started to use this for good. And Naveen was really good about asking these prompts and telling you really good ways to kind of structure this. And I want to give you guys a framework that I used to create companies as a DJ in some of the most aggressive and competitive markets, which is podcasting. I'm going to show you how we did that really simply. So we're going to use this for good. All right. And here's what's amazing. I am a brand new daddy right now. That's me. Yes, I'm your DJ. And the crazy thing that happened to me when I had little Rafa is, I know, right? Sorry, buddy, I had to use you. I realized, like all of us, that this is a time where I want my time back, right? I want to have as much time with him as possible. And so I realized that the frame that we had to use, it's not about getting all the prompts right. It's not about going deep down the rabbit hole on how do I tell it to get rid of employees? How do I tell it to do this? I really wanted to learn how to use this for good. And instead of getting overwhelmed, because do some of you guys get overwhelmed with this, right? Like, what do I ask it? I realized on a trip, I was in an Uber, and I was sitting with a single mom, and let's see here, next slide. These are her two kids. She said it was okay that I use this. Her name's Allison. She's a single mother of three boys in New Orleans. Now, I'm sitting in the back of this Uber, and imagine, have you ever been in an Uber where you're like, how in God's name is this car safe to be on the road and I'm in the back of it right now? That was this car, right? She's driving all over the place. I'm like, hey, what's what's the deal with your car? She's like, I just don't have any money to get it fixed. That's why I'm driving so much. I'm saving money to go to school because I need to make more money for my kids. I got three little kids, and I got to feed them. I'm a single mom. And I go, why are you going back to school? And she said, I'm going back to make more money so I can get a better education and make more money and have a better life for the kids. And we all know that that is complete bullshit right now. And so I pumped the brakes with her. I said, hey, why don't we do something real quick? Why don't I help you create a couple different jobs or job opportunities or ideas of a job right now while we're in the car? And she looked at me in the rearview mirror and she's like, well, how would you do that? I don't understand. And I opened up chat and I said, help me create 35 different job opportunities for a single mother of three in New Orleans right now. My mind started thinking. That spit out 30 different job opportunities that she could do with her kids in the car. It was aligning with restaurants, making little trinkets that you could sell. It was making digital maps that she could give to people as they were driving. It was things so outside of the field that I could even think of, but the frame I had was how can we use this for good? And I'm gonna give you that. I got pictures back and I'll show you if I catch up with you guys later. She sent me pictures later. She made an extra $600 that month for her kids as a single mom in New Orleans of color. How amazing is that? And that's why I say that this is the absolute game changer if you wanna use it in that fashion. So before I bring up vision and everybody, I like to use this stuff for good. This is some of the characters that we're writing for a children's book that we have with Rafa and my mom, or with my mom, she is my mommy, but it's my wife, with Ray. We're making an amazing children's book. I'm a year of the tiger. Rafa is a year of the tiger. I'm a year of the dragon, and mom is a year of the monkey. So we have a little children's book that we're creating called Mama Monkey, Daddy Dragon, and Tiger Tot. Take the adventures to the jungle, and we learn all about inclusion and the alphabet and all these things. So we're learning how to have fun with it, right? And then we go into all the animation, and we're gonna really dive into that with Vision, but I just wanted to set this frame for you guys because I am truly an accidental CEO. And right now, everybody here has the ability to build a business in the right way faster than any time in history. Any time in history. Because I am definitely what you would call an accidental CEO. I have no business, I had no business, I thought, being up here speaking with Vision after Naveen. But this technology that we're about to go into completely levels the playing field. This is the company that I run with Tiana, and she's in the audience here right now. We produce podcasts. And one thing that we realized really quickly is that this is a very aggressive space. How many of you guys have a podcast right now? Whoa, okay. Take a note of this. You want to talk to me later about this. Podcasting is an incredible field, but we realize podcasting is just not the only thing we need to do. We need to take the content that's here and we need to learn how to get it to as many people as possible. And I'm going to show you the three simple tools that we use to do that. And what's amazing about this, the framework that we used to do this, is a very simple thing I want you guys to remember when Vishen and Manon come up here. This is a framework that I like to call the head, the heart, and the hands. What does that mean? There's so much heady stuff right now when you're learning about AI. There's so many different AIs out there. I want you guys to first think about what's in your heart. Like, what is important to me when I'm learning this technology? Why do I need to learn this? Because then we're going to get in your head and we're going to show you some of the most amazing ones. And then after that, we're going to really show you what to do with your hands. What does that mean? That means that we're going to show you how to use the prompts. We're going to show you the fastest ways to use AI as a combination, because there's combination locks that you have to have. This AI is going to do this, this one's going to do this, and then this one's going to do that, and then boom, you've got it, right? So we want you guys to stay in that head and the heart, and then we'll show you how to use stuff with your hands. And that's what's beautiful with the mastermind that he's creating. But there's so much stuff out there. I want you guys to just keep this simple frame. If you can do that, it's going to really turn on how you can help somebody find a job. It's going to really turn on how you can really make an impact with people as you're moving through your daily activities and your life. And so one of the things you've realized, right, with AI, it is all about the prompts. You want to become a prompt engineer, but a prompt engineer, not just of like, hey, how can I streamline my company? How can I make more money? But really, how can I impact the world? And one of my favorite questions that I like to ask, this is from a book called The One Thing by Gary Keller, and it's, what's the one thing that I can do, that if done such that by doing makes everything else easier or unnecessary? And I use this question all the time. It's just a loaded question, right? It's a super loaded question. Like, here's a good example of that. What's the one thing I could do that if I do it, it makes the dance floor pop? It like makes everybody light up. And if I do that, it makes everything else easier or unnecessary. Let's play Latin music, right? That's one of my favorite things to do, is just to figure out the one thing to do. And you can do that inside your prompt engineering. Ask these really strong questions, and that's what's going to be the game changer for you. And then this is what we used to ask our clients. This is what we used to ask to really incite really good thoughts in our company. So you can fill in the blank there. How do we do this and have fun doing it? I love to add have fun, or with ease and grace. These are all the simple prompts that you can add that you may not think of. And we're going to show you with Midjourney. But what I like to do too is streamline this. So how do I create the most effortless workflow so that a ninth grader could do it? And that's one of my favorite things to do, because if I can show a kid how to do this, I can definitely show you guys how to do it, right? So here's our simple six-figure workflow. And this is just for podcasting. And these are three really simple tools. I just want to show you how these work. And the reason I'm showing you this is just to give you a framework of how simple three AI can work to make. And this makes us a six-figure workflow for our companies. We have, I think, 25 different shows that we produce right now. And some of them have upwards of 16 to 17 million downloads. And we're on track to do 90 million downloads between all of ours. And we're using this simple framework, not only just to create the show, but to take that show and turn it into a million different pieces. And then we're using that last app on the end called Decipher to make all the show notes and make everything really SEO rich. So the first one is Descript. Have any of you guys heard of Descript at all? Right? It's an amazing generator where you can actually take the audio and it will put the audio into this little engine and it will turn it into a podcast. You can add video, you can add text, you can do everything. It does it right there. You can linear edit, right? Like if you were using Final Cut Pro, but you don't have to be an editor. You can do all of it right there. Next, you have video.ai. We'll take that finished product, we'll put it into there. You can even put a YouTube link in there and it'll turn that YouTube into 30 or 40 different pieces of content instantly using the SEO that is driven by the vocal, by the audio. It doesn't, that's all you have to do. And then you pick which ones you want. In 30 seconds, you can have over 50 pieces of content that you can put everywhere. It's incredible. And then that last one on the end is called Decipher. And Decipher is what we use to create our show notes. Very simple formula. So you can see that's three different AI that has created an entire amazing business for me. And why do I want to do that? Going back to my head, my heart, and my hands. Because I'm adopted out of the Philippines. And if you don't know, my name is Shoebox Moses. Filipino? Yeah, there we go. My stage name is Shoebox Moses because I was super, super long story short, I was found in a shoebox as a newborn. And that's how I came to the United States. I was adopted. And I went back 7 years ago, found my orphanage. I had the ability to see the kids there. And I said, you know what? I can fix this. I know I can fix this. So I brought it back to my people like Vision. I said, I want to go back and I want to save these kids. I have no idea how I'm going to do that. And they said, you know what? That's a great idea. You're our little Shoebox Moses, aren't you? You're going to go set your little people free. And so that's where Shoebox Moses came from, if you guys have ever been wondering. But that's what's brilliant about this. This three simple steps, this framework. Can you teach your kids this? How many of you guys have kids? Could your kids learn this? Absolutely. Could a teenager learn this? In an instant. That's how we change lives. That's how we change the trajectory of what can happen right now, right? So I'm going to bring Vision and those guys back up. We're going to talk about Midjourney. We're going to go through those things with men. And what's crazy, look at this beautiful studio. That is not real. But this is. So think of this. Think of how you can use this to take the imagination, what's in your heart, and bring it to reality. And that's what we do every day, using this technology. All right, so this is something else that you can do. This is Morgan Freeman. We created this off of, this is, gets a little spooky, but I want you to hear what we're generating.
The Biology of Trauma podcast, a practical living manual for the human body. In a modern, traumatizing world, the human body is designed to adapt to its environment for its survival.
Does that sound like Morgan Freeman or what?
The world today has created biology of trauma that has to be addressed if you're serious about being the best version of yourself.
Right. So that is just a sample of what you can do in the vocals patterns. We can also do it with the visuals. And I only show you that just to kind of pique your interest because there is such a deep, deep rabbit hole that we're going to take you in. And I don't want you to get overwhelmed, but I want you guys to stay focused on what is the most important thing in your life. So get back in that heart space. Get back into what is amazing. And don't let ChatGPT flip you upside down, okay? Because what is the most important thing is that you have the ability to do what's really important and be with your kids. And I show you that because this is what life's about. It's not about doing prompts. It's not about trying to streamline your efficiency as a company. It's about dancing with your little girl at a party and a festival that you've created to keep your friends around you. So with that, Vision, come back up here and let's get a little techie on them. But thank you, guys. So remember.
Thank you, Sammy. By the way, I met Sammy at A-Fest. A-Fest Hawaii, like he was a member of the audience. And Sammy was just such a lovable character. We instantly bonded and now we've been friends for 12 years, mm-hmm. Right,
yep.
Right.
Thank you.
And even Jason Goldberg, Sammy and Jason are two of the guys in my life that I share everything with. We have a little like guys group on WhatsApp and we're like super vulnerable with each other. But all three of them, we met at A-Fest. And so I hope that you guys meet brothers or close allies like I did here at this event. Thank you, Sammy.
Yep, absolutely.
Oh, so I'm going to go into now some of the Mindvalley protocols for ChatGPT. So first, let's talk about image creation, right? AI is big in terms of generative art. And what you're seeing over here are images that I created for the Mindvalley blog. So I looked at our blog a couple of months ago and I realized that I hated it. It didn't inspire me. I would not share. The writing was decent, but I wouldn't share those articles with the public because the images sucked. The images were from Shutterstock and Getty Images. We're paying thousands of dollars to these companies to get the right to download these stock photography images, but the images were never good, and it was costing us thousands of dollars. And then I realized that, why are we bothering with this? We could basically create images that are original on our own using AI. But I wanted to do a test. Could we create better images than what we were paying $40, $50, $90 for on Shutterstock? And could we do it in under 3 minutes? So this is what happened. Now, this is using Midjourney. Okay, so Midjourney is a really wonderful AI, and you tell it what to create, and it creates an image for you. This was the original blog post, how to tell someone if someone likes you, 30 tips from a dating expert. Now look at that image, super cheesy couple dancing with the sun set behind them from Shutterstock. This is the new image created by AI. Now, it took 3 minutes. All we do is we plug in the blog post title into an instance of ChatGPT. We have trained ChatGPT to talk to Midjourney. So we've trained two AIs to talk to each other. Okay, and then ChatGPT tells Midjourney what to create. Here's another example. This involves Ken Honda. So we had a blog post about Ken Honda, the Japanese art of healing your money wounds. But I didn't like this image. It was blurry. And then in certain cultures, when you put things over a person's eye, you typically do that when the person is dying. And so I felt this image to certain cultures would feel a little bit off. This is the new image we created of Ken Honda. Okay, Japanese comic art designed by AI. You guess how long that took? About 2 minutes, 30 seconds. Again, only thing we had to do was plug into AI, Japanese art of healing your money wounds. Here's another picture, 7 parenting skills you need to raise conscious kids. This is the new image. Look, the AI image looks photorealistic. It captivates you. But then we decided to go further. These images are beautiful, but are they on brand? So we told ChatGPT, I want you to take into account branding elements that we use at Mindvalley. This includes light streaks, which is the photography style we do at A-Fest. This includes the colors purple and pink. This includes lit up positive faces. And this includes some subtle, you gotta say subtle, subtle variation of wings or flight or elevation. And then we needed to create a cover for a YouTube video. And the YouTube video had a very like basic title, The Importance of Gratitude to Elevate Happiness. This is what we plugged into AI and this is what it created. Notice the purple and the pink. Notice the light streaks. Do you see the subtle concept of elevation or wings that the light streaks are going this way? And then I really wanted to demonstrate how powerful this could be. So I took the face of my YouTube account manager and I put him in that dancing man. This is going to be his new Tinder profile. Now, another blog post on gratitude, it created this. This really blew me away because this light streaks was a design element that Paulius created for Mindvalley photography. When you look at the photography of A-Fest, you'll see light streaks. They do it with a little wobbling of the camera. AI immediately got that. And so when we created this beautiful picture of a woman for a blog post on happiness, it added the light streaks. And you can go further, right? This is this was created for a blog of YouTube cover on original cover sucked. But we created this, and it looks so much better. Now here we asked it to go deeper with the wings motif, and it came up with that. This was just for fun. This is actually Glenn. Glenn is the manager of our YouTube channel. You can put a person in the image. So that's how we got Ken Honda in that Japanese samurai. But you can just as well put a person in an image. Here's a classic example. This again is a picture of a blog post on Ken Honda. And Ken has a concept called Marrow Up. Now look at the image that the editor chose. Now I don't blame that. The editor is a writer. They're not meant to be a photography expert. But I told the editor, look, I'm gonna give you a ChatGPT account. I'm gonna train your ChatGPT. It took about 5 minutes to train. And then I told the editor, all you gotta do is paste the first paragraph, which is this. The word Maro is short for the form Mago, magokoro in Japanese. While a direct translation doesn't yet exist in English, a rough one would be state of selflessness or sincerity. Stick that in ChatGPT and it'll generate the perfect image to go with this blog post. And that's what it created. And you can see how much more beautiful that is to this. Okay, not that Ken Honda is not a beautiful man, but that image is not a great image. Look at the lack of creativity. And so all of this can be done with AI. Now, this image I really like, maximizing focus, how to not get distracted in a busy world. I love this image because it shows a woman with a headscarf. It represents diversity. It represents multiple cultures. But this image is not going to captivate someone. If you're writing a blog post or you're creating a YouTube video or an Instagram cover, your image must hook the person. So this is what we did. We asked ChatGPT, what makes an image attention-grabbing? And GPT responded, the image should have an unusual pattern. The image should have colors or brightness that captivates you. The image could have a human face that draws you in, as facial expressions sometimes do. The image must be unusual in some way. Now I tell ChatGPT, I want you to take this list you created and call it the image hook list. Now I tell it, now I'm going to give you a title for a blog post, create an appropriate image for this blog post, taking into account Mindvalley brand elements and the image hook list. Okay, so I'm speaking to it and I'm saying, take into account my brand, take into account what you know makes an image sticky. And this is what it now comes up with. So for the same blog post, with nothing more than typing in maximizing focus, how to not get distracted in a busy world, it came up with these images. It takes into account the light streaks. You will see the light streaks. It takes into account the colors of the Mindvalley brand, but it also captivates you. It pulls you in. There's a curiosity about the image, but I wasn't happy, so I asked it to go further, and these are the images it created. You can see how gorgeous these look. So here's another example, right? We replaced this image, instinct and intuition, with this image. This was an image where we were talking about manifesting. And in this blog post, the author was comparing manifesting to making an order on Amazon. But look at how awful that image looked. I told my blog writers, never do that again. Your job is to create art. If you cannot be an artist while working for Mindvalley, you are in the wrong company. And that is the new image they created. Instantly, in three minutes, using this instance of ChatGPT. Now to go further to show you how powerful this can be, I'm going to bring on Manon Dave. So Manon is a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant chap. Manon is the chief product officer of Mindvalley. He has a master's in artificial intelligence. He has invented 5 products since 2017 that have made Time Magazine's list of greatest inventions of the year. Last year, just last year, 2022, 2 of his products were listed in Time Magazine, one of which was the Rolly keyboard. On his side, just for fun, in addition to being chief product officer of Mindvalley, inventing products covered in Time Magazine, on his side, he composes music. His song with Idris Elba was just selected for the iPhone TV commercial. It's called Biggest. We should play it during one of the breaks. Another one of his songs just got selected for to commemorate the NASA moon landing. He's an absolute rock star. Manon, where are you? There you are. Come on up, Manon.
Awesome. Enter the geeks. Okay, here we go. So, as you can tell by my physique and the density of my glasses, I spend a lot of time speaking to computers. And in addition to that, I am also like a really big like comic book nerd. Any comic book fans here? Cool, my tribe, yes. Ascended losers, that's what we are known as. As Vishen mentioned kindly, you know, I really enjoy kind of just being creative. I'm chief product officer. I've been building products for 15 or 16 years, but I really have always been a creative at heart, hence the kind of music background. But being a creative, you know, sure, I create music, but anyone who is a musician here or works in any other creative field, you know that you would love to kind of like extend your creativity out into other fields. And for me, photography and graphics and imagery and even filmmaking to some degree, of course I have some ambitions there, but you know, I'd love to explore those different industries, and I've tried very hard to kind of, you know, pick up the hard skills that people like Paulius and Chi Ling and others have, But in reality, it's really, really difficult. There's that 10,000 hour problem. What Midjourney has helped me do is start to imagine again. And it's really, you know, as soon as I saw that the prompt that you type into the Discord channel to create an image is /imagine, my heart melted. I was like, this is it for me. I'm going to really spend a lot of time in this, which I have done. So everything that you see on my slides here is fully generated by AI, including this fake Cartagena beach. I was just trying to imagine what it was going to be like here. And I don't think it was that much of a miss. You know, it's pretty good. Maybe the ocean wasn't as blue, but it was fun. So I'm going to show you a little something that I put together, first of all, to mash up my hobbies and my interests with the AI. So I did a little gig, you know, a few months. I was hired as a consultant for HBO to help them kind of explore, you know, things like the metaverse and AI and other, you know, emerging technologies and how they could kind of play a part in that world. And after I finished with the contract, you know, I was geeking out about all of the NDA stuff they told me about DC Comics. And I thought, you know what, I'm just going to throw in a random bunch of prompts and try and create my own DC Comics themed HBO TV show concept. So all of these images are created by Midjourney using prompts that I put in, which I'm going to share with you guys. And this is sort of, this was Midjourney 5. So this was a few months ago when the photographic elements of Midjourney really started to develop. And I have, you know, I've got like this Monday morning syndrome when I come to events like this, which I'm sure many of you have. Like, I'm always like, what was that sexy dude on stage saying again about, you know, AI prompts and stuff? Lishan Vapianos or whatever his name was. You know, how do I actually use this thing in real life? So what I hope to give you guys is a little bit of a deeper dive into exactly how the structure of these prompts work and how you guys can replicate this in real time. And if we have time, maybe we do a quick demo. So HBO, the HBO original Rogue Streets does not exist. So please don't get me sued by posting this on your Instagram. All of the characters you see here are kind of my imagination or slightly tweaked versions of the famous characters. The Joker, you can see Poison Ivy, for those familiar, instead of the veins, it was tattoos, just to make it a little bit more realistic. Of course, Harley Quinn, Two-Face with a dirty scar on his face, the Penguin, Bane, and Catwoman. So I just really wanted to kind of imagine what this thing would look like if it was a TV show that I could enjoy and geek out over in my spare time. So this is how I did it. You know, inside of Discord, I used Midjourney and I created this prompt. I went through several iterations of this, and it's actually, you know, a few months ago or a couple of months ago, it was actually still a little bit difficult to get exactly what you had in your head out on the screen. And so I did various versions of this, but I landed on this particular prompt. And just to quickly run through it, I kind of like realized that the more I emphasize the subject of the image up front, so in this case, it's the Joker kneeling on a knee, his head is slightly tilted down. I said crater in the ground, and I think that it tried to write crater on the ground in the background, but so it didn't quite catch that one. I wanted it to be in the London streets, shocked people in the background. So you can see I'm kind of like trying to be as specific as possible. But as I kind of go further into the prompt, you start seeing that I'm sort of now describing more like the, let's say, the grading or the finishing elements of the image. So I want it to be epic and cinematic, and you can even specify the type of camera or imagery that you want. So in this case, I have no idea about cameras, so I just did a quick Google and was like, you know, what? How do I describe a camera? In this case, it says the IMAX 70mm sharp focus, film grain, all stuff that folks like Richard here in the front row probably know more about than me, but I just quickly Googled it and then ChatGPT'd that. And then the time of day. So I've basically tried my very best to be as descriptive as possible. And then there are these kind of what look like random parameters or you know, lines of code at the bottom. Now, these typically are generated by Midjourney if you don't emphasize them, but I'm now learning to utilize those. So the AR 16:9, that's the aspect ratio of the image, and you can manipulate that. There's a handful that you can leverage. V5 just refers to the version of Midjourney engine that you're going to use, and there are various pros and cons to each one, which if you catch me at the bar, we can go over. S is for stylize, so you can actually give Midjourney creative freedom to really apply its own, interpret your words into its own style, or you can be kind of in the middle like me at 250, where I'm like, you know, mostly listen to what I'm telling you, but then kind of just do your thing and jazz it up for me, please, as if one of my team members would. And lastly, Q, which is quality. So you can actually get really, really high resolution shots out of this, 4K, 8K shots, but it takes up tokens and whatever else, the way that they've monetized the system. But if you type none of that, you don't have to use any of those, you can still get a pretty powerful prompt. So whilst I've been here, I decided to go a step further, because whilst we've been here, Midjourney 5.1 was released. So in Midjourney 5.1, you can actually specify specific parameters that you would like to go deeper in. And I've, in the last 2 days, pretty much, developed this kind of mechanism in my own mind. For those who heard my toast, you know I like to use abbreviations. So this is one that's made up. It's Ozbek. And Ozbek, not to be confused with Uzbeks, is output, subject, background, emphasizers, and camera. So these are the things, these are the parameters that I use to really specify an image. So I'm going to show you how I use those specific five parameters in the last 48 hours to generate everything you're about to see. So the first one I sent to Vision on Instagram, on WhatsApp, just before our walking tour of Cartagena the other night. I was like, check this out, Vision. Look, I've now mastered the way to get real cinematic images. Again, geeking out on superheroes. This is Wonder Woman, and I specified here, I want the output to be a movie scene, an epic shot, in a cinematic style. The subject is a Colombian Wonder Woman, of which there are many, by the way. I wanted to be about 26-year-old. You know, I think that's how old Gal Gadot is, or thereabouts in terms of her character. Tall woman, beautiful. The background, I want it to be a Cartagena, old town. And I haven't been there yet, so I have actually no idea what it looks like other than what I found on Google. I want the influences to be tight cobble streets of Rome. Now, I've been to Rome, so I could use that as a reference and an influence of what I want the street to look like. I want it to be in this intense superhero fight scene feeling. And the emphasizers, which is a parameter that Midjourney have developed to really kind of dig into everything it knows about a specific style. So in this case, I use cinema core, so I want it to feel like a cinematic image. Desert core, I want it to feel kind of like sandy and dry and, you know, have that kind of yellow tone. And then I've again gone and Googled some cameras, and now I've gotten really deep on the specific lens and the specific, you know, exposure and focus and these things. So again, I'm not an expert in those things, but I'm able to tell Midjourney that I would like it to look like this. So that's Wonder Woman. That was done, I think it says here, it was the 4th of May, so literally the other day. And my favorite superhero is Rocket Raccoon from Guardians of the Galaxy. Anybody a Guardians of the Galaxy fan here? Awesome. So I said, in this case, I want, in fact, if I go back a second, I think that's also Dave Asprey in the back of that image as well. I said I wanted... just need to get a little bit more ripped, that's right. Oh my God, it's actually a yellow raccoon. There you go. It's actually a yellow raccoon. Who was supposed, didn't somebody say they were trying to manifest that? Oh my God, there you go. Wow, round of applause for John, wherever John is. That is wild. Thank you for noticing that. Wow, I'm actually blown away right now on stage. So in this case, I, again, specified this kind of cinematic feel. The Rocket Raccoon, a relaxed face, sunglasses. This was inspired by the beach party yesterday, by the way. So I literally did this morning at 10:17 a.m., as you can see, thinking about the beach party last night. And in this case, I've literally said Cartagena, luxury hotel, golf resort, all of the stuff that we're feeling. And I don't know about you guys, but to me, it feels like Rocket Raccoon was at the beach party last night. And one more image, and I'm going to ask for the apologies of Richard Schiff and Sheila Kelly here. I was talking to Richard over the dinner table about Midjourney and AI and the impact of these things. And, you know, of course, many people in the arts industry and many other industries are thinking, what is this thing going to do for my industry? And I'm really an optimist about it. And I really think that, you know, for folks like myself, people who are way deeper in the industry, people like Richard, I think this is a great tool. These are great tools in general to, I think, really crystallize an idea in the minds of the folks you're collaborating with. So the way that I've been using this with some of my friends and collaborators in the film industry is to take a script that they've written or co-written with ChatGPT and start to really build imagery around it to kind of show a studio or a potential cast member or a potential director what this film might look like. In my mind's eye, I imagine like some kind of Ocean's 11 meets The Godfather starring Richard Schiff shift, and the at least fictional debut of Sheila Kelly in this film. And so I created this amazing image of a thriller that I really, really want to watch. So hopefully Richard manages to find a way to get this funded and we can co-produce it together. Okay, yeah, done. There needs to be a little bit of a Sunday Riley face cream put on there and then we're good to go. So that's just the prompt I used for this one. And you know, Midjourney, again, uses its corpus and its internet of things that it's discovered, you know, the way that Richard Schiff looks across many different characters in his career and has tried its best to, you know, emulate his face within this shot. So I've shared a lot about cinematic use cases and the way that I've really tried to go deep on the way I articulate how I want a really epic image to look. But I just want to finish on a couple of things. These are other explorations that I've done on Midjourney over the last few months. Very, very quickly on the top left is my wife and I are decorating my son's bedroom, and we're on Etsy and finding cool bits of art and stuff, but he's really into trains and automotive, so we thought, why not create our own ones? And we're creating a vehicle themed around the world map for him using Midjourney, and we're going to print it in large, you know, on a large image or canvas and put it on the wall. Next to that is something I worked on many, many months ago with Volkswagen, who are trying to create a virtual world in the metaverse for an engagement that they're doing as one of their campaigns. And again, using Midjourney, I was just quickly able to ideate what that might look like. The one next to that is me. I'm dropping the EP very soon. You know, if you want to chat to me afterwards, I'll give you the Spotify links, but that's going to be the cover for my little EP that I'm putting together. Underneath that is an image of my friend's great-grandmother who passed away, but he found a bunch of her images, and he wanted to see if he could create photorealistic images for his mom to, you know, just for memory, and see if we could get really, really close to seeing her and creating her. He's an artist himself, so creating a gallery of those images. So that's a kind of reimagination by Midjourney of his great-grandmother. Next to that is something that I worked on with Christian Dior for the Atelier in Paris to create an interactive experience in the rooftop of that atelier. If you go to Paris today, you can actually check out, it doesn't quite look like that, but an interactive experience which we designed and was spawned through Midjourney. And the last one was an exploratory exercise I did with one of my friends, Idris Elba, who is working with Lego on creating tools for kids to learn how to do filmmaking and photography. Again, entirely generated by Midjourney, giving them a concept, an idea of how they could create a buildable camera for kids to learn about, high-scale photography. So that's kind of the gist of it, and I'm more than happy to go deeper. Everyone here by now knows that I like whiskey on the rocks. Get me one at the bar, and I'll show you more. But who wants to do a quick demo? Does anybody fancy? I need like probably two volunteers. Okay, cool. So, Chi, if you're at the back, if you can flick over to my Discord thing, if you just make sure you don't show any of the Manon and Jennifer Lawrence in Cartagena pictures, that would be great. I need a mic runner. Do we have a runner somewhere? Oh, there we go. Okay, so this gentleman here, I just need you to tell me what you want the subject to be. Try and be as descriptive as possible. It doesn't have to be a person. It could be a thing with, you know, just describe the material or the expression on the face.
Well, it's children being empowered with all the superhero imaginations so that we can transform the species and bring heaven on earth here. Yeah.
Beautiful. Children being empowered by all the superhero
powers.
Yep.
Benevolent powers.
Yep. Okay. You got that, Chi? Empowered?
And unimpinged by physical laws like gravity or electromagnetism.
Awesome. Let's go with smiling children with superpowers.
Yeah, smiling children. So not evil that. Children with superpowers.
I've seen that movie as well.
Yeah, I saw that too. That was horrific.
Then we need one more volunteer for the background. Somebody just describe a setting, a scene. Justine over here, who washed her face four times for the Sunday Riley bags. She's going to bring over the microphone. Any volunteers for a background? Over here, please.
Okay, background. Someone just shout it out.
Go ahead.
Okay. This is the thing. A whole country in the middle of a beautiful place, Colombia, raising a new flag, yellow, blue, and white. I'm feeling this new emotion about peace.
Just the background.
So the background was the country of Colombia with a flag raised in the middle.
Yeah, changing the color of the red part of the flag, you know? For us, it's violence.
Remember, be specific. If you go, if you're going to confuse the AI if you go into that detail,
perfect,
that level of depth.
That's cool. All right, we filled in the rest already with the stuff from Wonder Woman. So hit enter. Let's give it a few seconds. Any music, maybe?
Yeah, okay, while that's generating, thank you, Matt. So we'll come back to that.
Sure.
Okay, Chiling, I'll let you bring that screen back on while it's generating. It'll take about two minutes.
Well,
actually, it's going pretty fast.
All right, so we're going to see four images that it's created. And remember, this is pretty much just text to image in a matter of seconds. I think this is actually under a minute if this is working, which is pretty amazing. Let's wait for it to get 100% complete. And then if somebody just clicks the image once it's done, give it a second, almost there. Bam, let's hit that.
Yeah.
Amazing. Got pretty close.
Yeah.
Thank you guys very much. And hopefully if you want to see more, then give me a shout at the bar.
Okay,
thank you.
Thanks guys.
Thank you.
Okay, can we get my computer connected? So I want to show you how to apply this, how to go deeper with this. We're going to go super fast because we are running out of time. But one of the things I'm working on right now is building Mindvalley hotels and resorts around the world, right? So as I travel around the world and I look at that, I get inspiration. I tell ChatGPT to create the type of resort, to help me envision what these resorts would look like. I ask it to look at certain existing hotels for inspiration. So you can use this to ideate. You can use this to create proposals for things which have yet to be created. This is an example that Eric Edmead spoke about yesterday. I created a character called Adam. Let me show you the prompt. I had so much fun with this. You are going to take me on a journey through human history. I want you to pretend to be a man called Adam who was born precisely 100,000 years ago. You have witnessed human history from the beginning. I'm going to ask you to describe your experiences, feelings, and emotions. As Adam, you are now 100,000 years old. And then I go on to describe what it's seen from the fall of Baghdad to the birth of Christ. And now I can have conversations with Adam. Okay? Tell me about your first kiss. Okay? And now Adam here, who is a 100,000-year-old man who has witnessed human society from the dawn of history. Okay, so here it's being a little bit... it's probably because I have to remind it, so sometimes you got to go back to this instance and remind it. But let me show you. I asked it earlier to describe its journeys across time and put it in a graph. I asked it to describe the most horrifying thing it witnessed, and it said the Battle of Stalingrad. I asked it to describe Genghis Khan. Did you ever meet Genghis Khan? And so as you talk to Adam, he's teaching you history lessons. So if you are a teacher, this is really, really useful. Then I decided to ask Adam to familiarize itself with the work of Steven Spielberg and then suggest significant things it witnessed across human history that we could turn into movies. So I first asked it, what are the greatest historical movies in the world? And it said Gladiator. It said, it mentioned a couple of other movies as well. Gladiator, 12 Years a Slave. And then I said, based on everything you've seen, give me five ideas for a new movie. And then it talked about the rise of Genghis Khan, the construction of the Great Wall of China, the life of Leonardo da Vinci, the voyages of Zheng He, the French Revolution. Notice it's not just Eurocentric, right? It's looking at human history all the way to Chinese explorer Zheng He. And then I said, pretend. Now imagine you could download the wisdom of a great filmmaker like Steven Spielberg. Which of these events would you turn into an Academy Award-winning historical film? And it came up with the life story of Leonardo da Vinci. And it says why? Intriguing central character, rich historical setting, human drama and emotion, visual spectacle. Then I asked it to create a rough idea for a script. Okay, and it created a four-part act for a movie on Leonardo da Vinci. So you see how powerful this is? Okay, now, you can train ChatGPT to do what Manon just did and automatically create images for you. So this is called Diffusion Prompt Generator. So what I did was I trained ChatGPT to understand how people like Manon create these beautiful art images. And so so this is called an instance. It's a conversation where ChatGPT remembers what you told it and it replicates it. So I asked it first, are you familiar with Midjourney? So ChatGPT scoured the internet all the way till September 2021. So it wasn't familiar with Midjourney because Midjourney came out after September 2021. So I had to explain. I said, act as a stable diffusion photography prompt generator that accepts a visual description and outputs a detailed paragraph that I can copy into my diffusion model. Include a variety of photography related terminology, blah, 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 blah. Okay? And then it got it and it gave me an example. But its example wasn't correct. So I go to Midjourney. This is Midjourney. And I look at really great examples and I copy it and I give it to ChatGPT as samples. So I plug these into as samples. Example one, example two, example three. Now it says, I've analyzed the example prompts you provided. Okay, it tells me what it is. And now it is trained to do what Manon did and create rich art. So give me a blog post title. Anyone, just scream it out.
10 reasons you should come to A-Fest.
Okay, 10 reasons you should come to A-Fest. Okay, remember, you're using a proper noun here. Okay, so I just put this in. It's already trained. Okay, now it's saying, sure, here's an output in the format you trained me for. Now, I now take this and I paste it in here. Okay, now I can use this command, dash dash AR 169. This just means it's gonna be white rather than square. And what's gonna happen right now is it's gonna create the art for me. So if I'm writing a blog post, the art is instantly created. We're gonna come back to that. Okay, while it's doing that, let me show you a couple of other things. Script chunks for podcasts. So what I did was I fed my podcasts into ChatGPT. Okay, now how do you fit a large transcript into ChatGPT? Because there's a hack you can use. Okay, just go to conturata.com. This is created by one of our AI trainers at Mindvalley. And you wanna click on ChatGPT chunker. So when you have to fit a large amount of text into it, it has a limitation. I think it can only take in like 3,000 or 5,000 words. The podcast text is maybe 20,000 words. So you go to ChatGPT chunker, and then you stick your entire text in here, and it will break it down into chunks that you then paste into ChatGPT. So remember this website, conturata.com, okay? Conturata.com. Now, I stick my podcast chunks into ChatGPT, so it takes about 45 seconds to copy and paste. And then it accepts all of this. And then I ask it to summarize the podcast. Now, summarize this episode in 1,000 words. It nails it. Then I go further. I want to turn snippets of this podcast into viral Instagram videos. What are the main factors you would look for in a podcast snippet here that can go viral? So you don't tell it, now give me a viral Instagram video. Because what is a viral Instagram video? So I first get it to go into its memory. And I ask it, what makes a video viral on Instagram? And then it'll spit out what makes a video viral. In this case, emotional impact, relatability, high energy moments, actionable advice. Now I say, okay, now based on a birth, can you suggest a snippet with a high probability of going viral? And it goes through the podcast and it talks about this particular snippet where the speaker speaks about how even though she started 7 companies, she takes Friday off for self-care. And she only works 7 hours a day on the rest of the days. So she's working basically like 28 hours a week. That's it. And it suggests this title. Now I say, great, now turn this into a script. And it creates a script that I can send a junior editor who could be a 12-year-old. And the 12-year-old can put this video together. Now I can go further. The initial script is nice, but I tell it, I want you to observe NAS Daily. You guys know NAS Daily, the popular Instagram account? Create a script in NAS Daily style. And now it creates a script for a viral video in NAS Daily style. Then I say, okay, now imitate Jay Shetty. And then it now creates a script in Jay Shetty style. So this is a Jay Shetty script. So if Jay Shetty was creating a viral video, this is what it would look like. It's even given you the snippets to cut from the podcast, how long to display a snippet, what images to put in, all of this done for you. So you can see this is really, really, really powerful. You can even use it for customer support. I needed to figure out how to enable automatic subscriptions on my Wells Fargo card. I couldn't find the customer support document on wellsfargo.com, so I just said, hey, can you advise me on how to enable this feature on my Wells Fargo card? And it told me. So ChatGPT can do customer support for just about any service. So I wanted to find out how to find the ChatGPT API key, and it was able to, it basically told me where to look. You can use it for travel. So I was going to the island of Saaremaa, and I asked it, I'm traveling with a 9-year-old and a 15-year-old, what are the best things to visit? And it creates a travel itinerary for me. So now whenever I go to a city, rather than use Lonely Planet, I tell ChatGPT to create the travel itinerary specific because I have a 9-year-old with me. And then I could even say, and by the way, we love ice cream, so recommend some of the best ice cream stores and tell me exactly what time to visit the ice cream store. Everything done for you. So all of these are applications which are just absolutely stunning. Now, this is one of the craziest ones. So I hire writers to write, but they all have a different style. The style I love is the style I use for The Code of the Extraordinary Mind, my first book. That writing style was so effective, the book became the number one book in the world. It overtook the combined works of J.K. Rowling at one point because the writing was so compelling. How do I get ChatGPT to take a junior writer's work and output it as me? So this is what I did. So I took a chapter of my book and I feed it into ChatGPT. And I ask it, I tell it this, analyze the text below for the overall writing style. Take notes of things like my style, voice, sense of humor, language, tone of voice, and literary style. Using natural language, I then want you to create a prompt to write a new article in the same writing style. Let me know when you're ready for the text. So it now analyzes my text from The Code of the Extraordinary Mind, and it describes my writing style. Conversational, engageable, relatable. The tone of voice is friendly and encouraging, aiming to guide the reader towards self-improvement and personal growth. There's a sense of humor present as the author uses lighthearted language and refers to personal experience, such as the Taekwondo class. The literary style is primarily expository as the author explains various ideas and theories. Now it creates a prompt, okay? And now I can take this prompt, and the prompt looks like this. And I can ask it to basically take any article and convert it so that it's written by vision. So this is a poorly written article. The contractor was writing something from the writer Nurial. Now look at the part in yellow. Humans are creatures of habit. Therefore, if you learned at some point that using distraction would keep you safe and away from pain, chances are you're likely to repeat that unconscious pattern. According to Nur, we crave the relief from feeling bad rather than feeling good or getting a reward. The root cause of all distraction, he explains, is at some point in time, we found relief from pain by doing something else we didn't necessarily want to do. This is horrible writing. Horrible, horrible, horrible writing. I take that same thing, put it into ChatGPT, and I tell it, write like vision. And this is what it does. It comes up with a quote that doesn't exist anywhere. An original quote, because all my book titles start with quote. All my book chapters start with quotes. Distractions are like little gremlins, always ready to pounce and steal your focus when you least expect it. And then it goes on to write like me. Ah, distractions, those pesky little critters that seem to follow us around, just waiting for the perfect moment to sabotage our productivity. As humans, we are creatures of habit. And let me tell you, distractions have a sneaky way of weaving themselves into the fabric of our lives. According to Nurial, the guru of focus and author of Indistractable, we're all just seeking a little relief from feeling bad. Distractions, he explains, are born from our desire to escape pain by doing something else, anything else that doesn't make us feel so lousy. You see the difference? Same message. It is not just corrected for grammar, it's completely rewritten it the way I would write it. What this means is Mindvalley no longer needs to hire professional writers. We can hire 12-year-olds, seriously. We don't need advanced graphic designers. We can hire 12-year-olds. I'm actually doing this experiment. Okay, maybe 12-year-olds, they need a little bit more focus. Son who's 15 is, Hayden, are you in the room? Yes, right? So Hayden's gonna join Mindvalley and he's gonna start creating art and writing for the Mindvalley blog. And this is his first AI training. Next month, he'll be a master of this. So basically, what this means is we can all start using child labor, people, and save so much money. No, I'm kidding. What this means is that if you're not using AI, you are going to be replaced by someone who's using AI. And honestly, the hardest thing I'm facing in my company right now is that many employees are not embracing this. For some reason, there's this inertia. And so I'm investing a lot to bring in AI trainers to talk to my employees, but there's still this inertia in about 40, 50% of it. I cannot understand why, but that 40, 50% are going to be in fucking trouble. And the ones who are embracing AI, their output, their productivity, they're going to get the promotions. They're going to get countless job offers. They're going to get so good at what they do. You can see this already. The world is going to be split, and there's going to be two types of people, and it's not going to be those who have a college degree and those who don't. It's going to be those who know how to use ChatGPT and Midjourney and those who don't. College degrees are officially useless. You don't need a college degree. Prompt engineers, which is what I'm teaching you here, if you learn prompt engineering, you can already get a job. One prompt engineer, no college degree, got a job offer for $360,000 a year. If you master prompt engineering, companies want you. IBM this week announced that they're no longer hiring. They are simply going to retrain their workforce because they don't need to hire anymore. They cut 13,000 jobs because their existing workforce with prompt engineering can do so much more. Why hire? We're going to see changes in the world happen in the next 5 years. I was at an XPRIZE event with Naveen Jain, and Peter Diamandis said, he was quoting a conversation he had with Elon Musk, and Elon said basically, it is not a question of if we will adopt a four-hour work week, it is a question of when. And I think what's probably going to happen is we are going to come down to 20-hour work weeks pretty soon, because so much can be done right now with AI. People would get paid the same, but they would be doing their job in 20 hours. And this is actually a beautiful thing because it gives you 2.5 hours a week to spend time on your health, on your family, on your hobbies. We are going there. You're going to see 4-hour work weeks extend to 4-day work weeks, extend to 3-day work weeks, extend to 2-day work weeks. People are not going to be unproductive. They're just going to be creating art and projects. And using AI in new, beautiful ways.